We will go to Revelation 9, the fifth trumpet. As we saw last time, the first four trumpets, which effect was on natural things, and which also you could, if you want, explain naturally, and I'm sure most people at that time will explain it naturally. And we see that all their effects are always on a third, third of the earth, a third of the waters, etc. Which shows, for one thing, that God always spares more than he slays, and with the purpose, of course, to bring people to repentance. And that is what we see the whole time so far. And it will continue. But there is a difference between the first four trumpets and the last three, in the sense that it goes from more natural in character to more supernatural in character. And that will also, there you see also the increase in the effect that it is supposed to have on men. What they get first, they will, for the larger part, dismiss as being natural things and just bad luck. But when it comes to supernatural things, you cannot say it anymore. You have to admit there's something other at work. And it has to be either God or you have to replace him with something else. So the fifth trumpet is also one of the plagues. I like to call them plagues and not so much judgments because of their character, but okay, it doesn't really matter. But there is a lot of words spent on this one trumpet compared to the other ones. Sometimes it's only one verse or two verses, but here we have half the chapter for the fifth trumpet and half the chapter is the sixth trumpet. And so on, the seventh trumpet is then later in chapter 10. So this spans verses 1 through 12. So let's just first read it so that we know what we are talking about. And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth. And unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, nor, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion, when he striketh a man. And in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the fourth of the locust were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and on their heads were, as it were, crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men, and they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle, and they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue his name Apollyon. One woe is past, and behold, there cometh two woes more hereafter. Okay. Now there is a whole lot of talk and explanations about this, and we will do another attempt. But I've studied this in the past, and now that I was preparing and reading, some new revelations came to my mind, actually. So, as I said, one thing is fundamentally changing here. The character of this plague is supernatural. And it is the fifth trumpet, and we see also that the period of torment is 5 months. So the number five is important here. And I want to linger a little bit on this number, because I believe this is not by chance that this is and the fifth trumpet, and that the period that these so-called locusts are allowed to torment men is 5 months. Now, we know, of course, the number five from Scripture as being the number of grace. It's the five wounds that Jesus had. We have in the names of Abraham and Sarah the fifth letter, the He, added to their names to as a token of grace to fulfill or to seal the promise of the covenant in their names, actually. And we also have King David. He wasn't king yet, but who took five stones out of the river bed. And so there are many examples where we see that five, it points always to Jesus, to grace. It's a number of grace. But as we also saw the other time, where there is grace, it's up to men to either accept it or to reject it. When you accept it, that leads to salvation. When you reject it, judgment will come. And I think here we see this flipping point where man that has rejected this gift of salvation will be judged, or at least will get a very severe sign. Now, when I've talked in the past several times about numbers, and throughout Scripture there are many numbers used, and it's always, well, to say the least, interesting to look at them, because they give an extra meaning to Scripture, and often an extra explanation of things. You can go very far in that, and it's not necessary, everything that God does and does for good, Satan copies and makes it into something evil. So we see from all the numbers that we have in the Bible that have a good meaning, there is also a counterfeit that Satan has created that has a bad meaning. So, for example, the number 13, that we know, for example, Jesus had 12 disciples, so the disciples plus Jesus were 13. But 13 is a very bad number in an occult sense. So Satan has made it into something bad. And with the number 5, it's the same. 5, as I said, is a number of grace. But it is a number that is very, very important in occultism. And you can say, okay, we don't need to know anything about that. That is true. But when we continue in the book of Revelation, we will come at some point to chapter 13, in verse 18, where it says that the number of the beast is the number of man. It's the number 666. And so there is there specifically a number mentioned for a reason. And of course, we will go into that when we get there. But it's also tied to this number 5. And in the world that we live in, we are continuously bombarded with symbols and numbers and words also that are have an evil background that Satan has actually introduced, or that people that worship him use to convey their message, to put a stamp or signature on that which they have put a curse on, for example. So it is good for us to a certain extent to recognize these things, that we know that something is going on, because we can often not perceive these spiritual things, also the wicked spiritual things, but they usually leave their mark. So what I did here is draw a circle And if you divide a circle, which is of course 360 degrees, if you divide it in five, you have pies, as I call them, that have an angle of 72 degrees. 5 times 72 is 360. Now, why is that important? I will explain. First of all, you have 360 is a 3 and a 6. No, 3 times 6 is 666. So the circle represents the number of the beast just by its angle, 360. So you always have to take the numbers apart in separate numbers. So 3 times 6, 6 plus 6 plus 6. That is what 3, 6 says. And whether it's 36 or 360 or 3600, that doesn't matter because the zeros are zero. They don't count. So that is what the circle actually represents. You will find in many occult symbols a circle. Simple, a circle with a dot, the snake who eats his own tail. These are all circles. The yin-yang symbol, it's also a circle. And so there are many of these symbols. But you can multiply 3 and 6. You can also add them. 3 plus 6 is 9. So 9 is often used as a number to represent 666. They don't write 666. That's too obvious. They will write 9. So, but this is a covered way to show their mark. you can also multiply 3 times 6 is, of course, also 18. 6 plus 6 plus 6 is 18. That's a 1 and an 8. If you add the 1 and the 8, you get again the 9. So you see the 9 from different angles represents 666. Now, I said that if you divide 360 by 5, you get 72. And 72 happens to be 66 plus 6. So 72 is just another way to write 666. 66 plus 6 adds up to 72. And that is an interesting number because there is the word curse, which is used many times in the Bible. It is actually used 66 times in the Old Testament and 6 times in the New Testament, the word curse. So this represents actually what God counters it with, this evil. Now 72 is 7 and a 2. You can add the 7 and the 2 or subtract actually. 7 minus 2 is again 5. So you are back to the beginning. 360 divided by 5 is 72. 7 minus 2 is 5 again. But 7 plus 2 is 9, which is again a representation of 666. And 7 times 2 is 14. You add the 1 and the 4, you have again 5. And if you want to add the 5 and the 9, you get again 14. The 1 and the 4 is again 5. So you see how it comes back to the same thing in the end. And the people, Luciferians, they like this stuff very much. They can go on with this forever and put all these signs and things into their products, you can say. I put here on purpose this $1 bill, which is completely flooded with occult symbolism. I made once a presentation only about this dollar bill. You can really talk an hour about all the symbols that are in here. But one thing we know, of course, is this pyramid, which is like, you could say, the logo of what we usually call the Illuminati. But it has 13 layers of stones, 13. But if you count the number of stones, it's 72. And of course, it's not by chance. This is just saying, in your face, 666. And so you see that these Luciferians, they have put this everywhere, and people are dealing with it all the time. And this is a form of what they call white magic. They can convey curses and things through this symbolism. Now, to come back to this circle divided in five, we can, of course, connect these dots. And you can do that in several ways. One is this. And then you will get a pentagon. A pentagon is another one of these symbols that they use. But you can connect them in another way. And then you get the pentagram, which we usually associate more with occultism, witchcraft. So that's these both pentagram, pentagon, and the circle itself, they are all symbols that they like to use a lot. And so this all comes from the five, and the circle, of course. And the pentagram, of course, it's the five-pointed star. So you see this five. We will get to another verse in scripture where we also see how five is linked to evil. Pentagram, the pentagon, there is another, an Arabic symbol called Hamsa, which is actually, it's a hand, but it looks like it has two thumbs, but anyway, it's five fingers. So again, this number five. And it's used also in Judaism, Kabbalistic Judaism, or even Talmudic Judaism, they use this symbol also a lot, and they wear it as even as jewelry. It has six points, not five. Yeah. What they call the Star of David, but that is part of the Seal of Solomon. So if you have the Seal of Solomon, it has on one side it has the pentagram, on the other side the hexagram, which we called the Star of David. It's not the Star of David, but anyway, it's a hexagram. And if you know the word hex, a hex is also a curse. This is, in witchcraft, they use both. Every Masonic lodge at the entrance has the hexagram and the pentagram, both stars. This is very occult symbolism, actually. And you find in here. Okay, so maybe we sidetracked too much now, but in here you have also the hexagram, so the Star of David. You can there is text here written around it.
Which
you
can, not the Star of David.
No, that's what I say. It's part of the Seal of Solomon. It's occult. But you can connect these letters. You get this hexagram, and the letters that you have form the word Mason. So, Mason. And there are more hexagrams in the book. Okay, we sidetracked too much. There is a lot of this symbolism. Now, the number five is also linked to the planet Saturn. So Saturn is also a god. What they worship as Satan. Actually, Saturn represents Satan. It's interesting, I was thinking of this Saturn, and then I was thinking of a rocket scientist that you might know or not, called Werner von Braun. And he was one of Hitler's scientists. And in the Second World War, he created the V1 and V2 rockets, which were actually very advanced for that time. They were intercontinental missiles. They were fired from Germany, and they went as far as into London, so they could send these rockets. And I've spoken with people in Holland that saw them flying over. They didn't go as fast as today's missiles, but they could actually see them flying over, and they would go all the way to London. So that was his invention. And after the Second World War, he was not locked up in prison, but he was actually, he went to the United States, or he was helped to get there, and he was hired by NASA, and he is the one who developed the rocket that allegedly brought man to the moon. And this rocket, the name of this rocket, the moon rocket, is Saturn V. That's the name, Saturn, and then Roman V5. So you have there three things, and I will come back to that. The Saturn, you have the five, And the whole moon mission is called Apollo. Every rocket that went to the moon was Apollo 1, Apollo 2, etc. So there is a link between all of this. It's not by chance. These people, these scientists, they were all occultists. Very much. That's where they got their inspiration, let's say. There is this link between five and between evil. And we can find it in Joshua, in chapter 10, verse 22. Now, Joshua, of course, was the successor of Moses, let's say. He was the one to lead the people into the promised land. And then he had to lead many battles to conquer all these tribes that were offspring, by the way, of the Nephilim. They were Nephilim tribes. That's why they had to be eradicated. And there in chapter 10, verse 22, it says, "Then said Joshua, open the mouth of the cave, and bring out those five kings unto me out of the cave." So there were five kings that they had captured, taken captive, and they had locked them in a cave. And here he says, open the cave and get these five kings out. And this is like a foreshadow of what we just read in Revelation 9, where it is actually an angel that falls from heaven that opens the pit, and out comes evil. And evil is associated with five. This is these five kings. What is interesting here, that in this story, it's Joshua who gives the command. Now, we read Joshua, it's English, but it's actually Yehoshua. It's Yeshua. It's exact same name as our Savior. So Yeshua gives the command to open the pit. And in this case, if you would read the rest of the story, the five kings are killed, and their bodies are then thrown back into this cave. So it's interesting to see who's in control of this. And that's what actually is also the case in Revelation 9. It's God who's in control and no one else. So if we want to understand this this story that we read in Revelation 9, and I have played with different explanations or interpretations, if you will. But there are a few things. We have, first of all, we have the bottomless pit. And we have an angel with a key to open the pit. We have locusts that come out of the pit. And we have an angel called Abaddon or Apollyon, who is the king over these locusts. Let's call them locusts for sake of ease. So we have four things, eh? The pit, the angel, the locusts, and another angel who is the king over the locusts. So I just want to look at these four things. What do they mean? What do they represent? First of all, the bottomless pit. If you look it up in a dictionary, Cambridge Dictionary, for example, says a bottomless pit is something that seems to have no limits, or a situation that will never end. So, okay, that makes sense, but that doesn't really help us so much. It is also often called, and many Bible translations use this word, the abyss, which is, of course, from a Greek word. And but the biblical meaning, according to the Hebrew tradition, because the word, the Greek word, it comes from a Hebrew word, and in the Hebrew tradition, it is something that has an unfathomable depth beyond our imagination, and which is the home of the dead and of evil spirits. That is what it means in Hebrew, in biblical tradition. So that's interesting, because we will find this actually in other places in Revelation. So we have to compare a bit what is written there. For example, if we forward to Revelation 11, verse 7 and 8, Revelation 11 is about the two witnesses, and they get at some point killed. And it says in Revelation 11, verse 7, And when they shall have finished their testimony, so that's the two witnesses, the beast that ascended out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them. So here we see that the beast will ascend out of the bottomless pit. And here in Revelation 11 it says the beast that ascended. It doesn't say that it ascends at that moment, because the actual fact where moment where it, the beast ascends is in Revelation 13. So basically Revelation 11 is forward, flashing forward to Revelation 13. But we see he comes from the bottomless pit. That's interesting. I'll come back to this. And at the end of the tribulation, when Jesus returns, we have again mention of the bottomless pit in Revelation 20, verse 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. And he will then take Satan and bind him for 1,000 years in the bottomless pit. So it's the same place, apparently. So the opening of the pit here in verse 9 is not permanent, apparently. It is for a short time for these locusts to come out, because afterwards, certainly in Revelation 20 it's very clear, there comes another angel with a key to open it and to bind Satan. So it isn't open permanently. And that also shows that God is in control. God allows it to a certain extent, but only to a certain extent. What is interesting also that we see both in chapter 9 and in chapter 20 that it is an angel with a key that opens the pit. What we also see in Revelation 9 is that the power of these locusts is only for 5 months, so it's also limited. So it shows God has set limits. He allows it, but he within limits. And that is something that has been foretold 2 times actually. First is in 2 Peter, verse 2, chapter 2, verse 4, 2 Peter 2, verse 4. For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell, and delivered them into chains of darkness, to be reserved unto judgment. Here, Peter uses the word hell, which might be for us confusing to say this is the same as the bottomless pit, but from the context of angels being chained there, it makes sense that it is what Revelation calls the bottomless pit and not so much hell where there is torment everlasting. Jude also makes mention of this in verse 6. And there you see he does not use this word hell as Peter does. Jude writes, and the angels which kept not their first estate but left their own habitation he had reserved in everlasting chains under darkness unto the judgment of the great day. So again here we see angels that left their first estate, the fallen angels, they are chained there, are bound there. Now, what we just read from Revelation 9, we see that locusts come out. So these are not the angels that are bound there. These are other creatures that are apparently also present there. And only one angel is mentioned. That's Abaddon. Which doesn't mean that there are not also other angels bound there. But they are just not mentioned in that specific section. Now, Scripture does not give so much more details, but both Peter and Jude, they quote from Enoch. So if we go to Enoch, we have much more information. And so I want to read the section from Enoch where it speaks about the binding of these angels. From Enoch chapter 10, verse 6 through 9, it says, again the Lord said to Raphael, this is one of the 7 angels that's before the Lord, the Lord said to Raphael, bind Azazel hand and foot, and cast him into darkness. And, opening the desert, which is in Dudael, cast him in there. Throw upon him hurled and painted stones, pointed stone, sorry, covering him with darkness. There he shall remain forever. Cover his face that he may not see light. And in the great day of judgment, let him be cast into the fire. That last is what we will read, of course, later on, after the 1,000 years. They're released and cast in the lake of fire. So here it is the angel Raphael who gets a task to bind this specific angel called Azazel, which we know, by the way, as Azazel from the Old Testament, to cast him in this pit, which has an opening in the desert. That's on the earth. And he even gives the name of a place, Dudael. I come back to this, because these are interesting clues. Then, this is what God says to Raphael. And Enoch simply describes this, just as John describes what he sees in his vision in the book of Revelation. But just as John, also Enoch is then taken up in the spirit, and he gets, you could say, a tour through the heavenly realm, both the demonic heavenly realm as well as where God resides. And then he sees this place actually himself, and he begins to describe it. And that is in Enoch chapter 21, verse 1 through 6. And he writes, I made a circuit to a place in which nothing was completed. And there I beheld neither the tremendous workmanship of an exalted heaven, nor of an established earth, but a desolate spot, prepared and terrific. There too I beheld seven stars of heaven, bound in it together, like great mountains, and like a blazing fire. And I exclaimed, for what species of crime have they been bound, and why have they been removed to this place? Then Uriel, one of the holy angels who was with me, and who conducted me, answered, Enoch, wherefore dost thou ask? Wherefore reason with thyself, and anxiously inquire? These are those of the stars which have transgressed the commandment of the Most High God, and are here bound, until the infinite number of the days of their crimes be completed. From thence I afterwards passed on to another terrific place, where I beheld the operation of a great fire blazing and glittering, in the midst of which there was a division. Columns of fire struggled together to the end of the abyss, and deep was their descent, but neither its measurement nor magnitude was I able to discover. Neither could I perceive its origin. And then I exclaimed, how terrible is this place, and how difficult to explore. Uriel, one of the holy angels who was with me, answered and said, Enoch, why art thou alarmed and amazed at this terrific place, at the sight of this place of suffering? This, he said, is the prison of the angels, and here they are kept forever. So he gives a very colorful description and goes on through all these chapters. It's actually beautiful to read, especially where he sees the beauty of heaven, very poetic and gives you really a feeling. But we see here he calls these angels stars. So this is the same use of words that we also find in the book of Revelation. We just read it, a star fell from heaven and him was given the key. It doesn't say angel, but star. But we know that often this is synonymous. And it's the place where the angels are bound. So it's a physical place. Enoch could perceive it. And it has apparently an entrance in the wilderness, in the desert, on earth. But then there is a separation that we cannot not cross, and also the angels not from the other side. They are bound there. And that's why there is a key necessary to open this place. A key requires a lock, and a lock requires a door in which the lock is put. So there must be a door, a gateway, an opening, one or more. Now, Enoch gives the name of this place, Dudael. Now, El is just an addition, which means God, we know that. So the root is Duda. And that gives us a link. God tells then to the angel Raphael to bind the fallen angel Azazel there. So we know Raphael and Uriel, they are the good angels. They are part of the seven that we saw that are before the throne of God. But Azazel is one of the fallen angels who fell together with Lucifer. He's one of the troop of the 200 that came down, that are mentioned in Genesis 6, that came down and went with the daughters of men, from which the giants were born. And this Azazel or Azazel we find in the Old Testament, in Leviticus in particular. So let's go there, and we see that everything comes together again. Leviticus 16, verse 7 through 10. Here we have the description of the replacement sacrifice. God begins to show this with Abram, asking Abram to sacrifice his son Isaac, and then before Abram does so, God stops him and then provides a goat that is there stuck in the bushes. That is the replacement sacrifice, which points, of course, to Jesus, who would be the replacement sacrifice for all men. But then this would be repeated in the tabernacle and the temple, specifically at the Day of Atonement. So in Leviticus 16, verse 7, it says, "And he, that's Aaron, or the high priest, shall take the two goats and present them before the Lord at the door of the tabernacle of the congregation. And Aaron shall cast lots upon the two goats, one lot for the Lord and the other lot for the scapegoat." And so this is what we later on see with Jesus, the Messiah, and Jesus, Barnabas, the two goats that are presented, and one is the scapegoat. "And Aaron shall bring the goat upon which the Lord's lot fell, and offer him before him for a sin offering. But the goat on which the lot fell, to be the scapegoat, shall be presented alive before the Lord, to make an atonement with him, and to let him go for a scapegoat into the wilderness." Now here King James says wilderness, for a scapegoat into the wilderness. But in the Hebrew it doesn't say scapegoat, it says Azazel. He shall go into the wilderness for Azazel. And there is actually a ritual that Hebrews did. They would literally bring this goat into the wilderness and to a crevice and throw it down from the rocks. And this symbolized that he would go into this pit that they didn't know where it was, but they would just take a certain spot where they could throw him off the rocks. So we find traces of this this pre-flood story that Enoch writes back even in the sacrificial ritual of the Day of Atonement. So there is a place where there is the entrance, as it says in Enoch chapter 10, an opening in the desert, as if the earth opens and there is the entrance. And the name is Dudael. Now, there is a whole explanation, but etymologically you can retrace this word Dudael to Babel. Babel, which we know, Babel, Babel. It's the same word. It's the same origin. And now it becomes also interesting what we just read from Revelation 11, where it says that the two witnesses are killed by the beast that ascends from the bottomless pit. Now we know this beast that will kill the two witnesses is the Antichrist, is the second beast in Revelation 13. And if you see in Revelation 13, in verse 11, it says, "And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth." So in Revelation 11 it says, out of the bottomless pit. In Revelation 13, speaking about the same beast, it says, out of the earth. In other words, the bottomless pit is under the earth. This place is under the earth. And this is in line with what Enoch describes. It's an opening in the earth. And Enoch gives this name which links it to Babel. And it also makes sense that he uses another word, because the name Babel did not exist yet until after the flood. But he uses an older form of this word. Now, when I came to this revelation, it makes also sense why Nimrod was so keen on building the Tower of Babel there where he was building it, because that was the place where there was the entrance to the, let's call it, underworld. That is what he wanted to open. He had already begun to become a giant, a Giborim. And we talked about it when we talked about the names, when we went through the genealogy. He had figured out to do that, but he wanted the power of the fallen ones that were there before the flood. But they were locked in this bottomless pit, and he wanted to open this. So, and that was the whole purpose of the Tower of Babel. And so, then you begin to read again what happened in Genesis, Genesis 11, where we see this Tower of Babel. In Genesis 11, verse 6, God stops Nimrod. Why? Because apparently Nimrod, if God would not have stopped him, he would have succeeded in what he wanted to do. In other words, he had the key. He had the key. And he was going to succeed. And thus God had to stop him in Genesis 11, verse 6. And the Lord said, "Behold, the people is one, and they have all one language. And this they began to do. And now nothing will be restrained from them, which they have imagined to do." Nothing will be restrained from them. In other words, they will succeed in what they want. And thus God confuses them, and they are scattered. But this is what was going on. Now, in Revelation 9, God allows it to happen. That's the difference there. Then I was thinking about this tower. Why this tower? And we think always of a tower that is very high. Why do we think that it is high? It is a very interesting thing to think of. In Genesis 11 also, in verse 4, it said, "And they said, go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name." So, we're going to build a tower that reaches to heaven. Here it says, whose top reaches to heaven. So I thought, this does not make sense. If this pit is under the earth, why would he want to go up? There's no reason. So then I have this little voice, look it up in the Hebrew. You look it up in the Hebrew, what this verse says, it's actually two words. It says, verasho, which is translated as who's top. And then you have bashamayim, which means to heaven. Or reach to heaven. It's just two words. And the first word, verosho, is based on the root rosh, which we know very well. Rosh is this word that means chief or king or prince, that is often used for Jesus, actually. Paul does it brilliantly in Colossians 1, though it's written in Greek. But if you would write it in Hebrew, it would be perfect. Hey? Where he says that everything is created for him and in him, and he is from the beginning, and everything holds together in him. He uses the word Rosh there, if you would say it in Hebrew, I think 10 times or so. It's really beautiful how this is constructed. But we know the word also from Rosh Hashanah, the beginning of the year, or the head of the year. So it's king is also head, the head of the year. which we would say in normal language the beginning of the year. We also know it from Genesis 1, verse 1. The first word in the Bible is Bereshit, in the beginning. It also contains Bereshit, Resh is also Rosh, which is the beginning. It's the beginning of the year. It's the beginning of creation. So that's what it means, beginning. Now, in a tower, you can say it's the head of the tower, it's the top. But you actually doesn't say that. It says the beginning of the tower. Where is the beginning of the tower? On the earth. That's where you begin to build. And you go up. So, you can say the top of the tower reaches to heaven. You can also say the beginning of the tower reaches to heaven, which is the where it rests, the floor on which it rests, reaches to heaven. The heavens is Bashamayim, which is the heavenly realm. It is also used, this word, for the sky. Just as we say heaven, we can think of that where God resides, or the gods, if it's the spiritual realm in general. But we also use it for the sky. And that's the confusion. We think of a tower, we think automatically of going up and of the sky, and so we make this link. But it's actually not what it necessarily says. If this heavenly realm refers to the demonic heavenly realm, and it's down, then that's the purpose of the tower. Then only other question you could have is, why does it need to be a tower? Well, for some reason, Nimrod had figured this out, apparently, and I think he had to have some help for that. But for some reason, he needed a vehicle, a mechanism, some technology to open this gate, because it cannot just be opened by digging in the earth or something. It has to happen in a more or less supernatural way. And so he had figured out a way to break the veil between this, our physical realm, and this under earth or underworld. And so he had built this tower. Now, what I was thinking is, and I will get to why, is that he needed a lot of energy to do that. And he didn't have some electricity plant to get energy. So how do you get lots of energy? Think of this scientist called Tesla, who built also towers to harvest energy from the atmosphere, from lightnings, lots of electricity. And so this is was my thought. Something like that is probably the reason why it had to be a tower that would go up, not super high, but it had to be a high point in order to attract, for example, lightning bolts for energy. If you think of Babylon, the meaning of the word Babylon is exactly this: gateway to the God, to God, actually, right? Gateway to God. So it all makes sense. Also, from what we can read in Isaiah 13, when we read from this, also when we spoke about the fourth seal. And Isaiah 13 is one of these chapters that is in almost all Bibles translated a bit awkward from the Hebrew. And the only good translation is actually the Septuagint, the original Greek translation from the original Hebrew text. And it says in verse 2 and 3, "Lift up a standard on the mountain of the plain, exalt the voice to them. Beckon with the hand, open the gates, you rulers. I give command and I bring them. Giants are coming to fulfill my wrath, rejoicing at the same time and insulting." This is Isaiah 13, verse 2 and 3, according to the Septuagint. So what does it say? Lift up a standard on the mountain of the plain. So here you go with your tower, and open the gates. I give command, God is still in control, and giants are coming to fulfill my wrath. So here coming these creatures out of the earth to fulfill the wrath after the gates are opened. And even here he uses this words to lift up a standard, to build this tower or construction, to open this gate. The word gate is petach in Hebrew. It literally means opening or doorway or entrance. So it can be as simple as a hole, or it can also be like a proper door. And the word for giants here is gibor. It's the same word that is used in Genesis 6, gibor, or in the plural, giborim. It's mighty man. It's the same that is being said of Nimrod in Genesis 10. He began to become a mighty man. Usually says a mighty hunter, a mighty man, a gibor, a giant. And then in Isaiah 13, verse 21 and 22, it describes what creatures will come out. And then you begin to understand a bit what John tries to describe when he describes these locusts. It says, "But wild beasts shall rest there, and the houses shall be filled with howling, and monsters shall rest there, and devils shall dance there, and satyrs shall dwell there. And hedgehogs shall make their nests in the houses. It will come soon, and it will not tarry." So you get a bit of an idea of this this torment that lasts 5 months. If this kind of terrifying creatures will enter into the houses and will sting the people. So the abyss, the bottomless pit, is a place that is accessible from our physical world, and it has, I think, more than one gate to get there, but it requires a specific key, a specific procedure, if you will, to open it. Then there is the mention of this angel with a key, and this is also interesting because I was thinking, okay, an angel, so it's God who is doing this. It's an angel of God. And if you compare Revelation 9 verse 1 with Revelation 20 verse 1, it is almost the same. So it's really a matter of find the differences. And again, you will see something interesting. In chapter 9 it says, "And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit." Just like Enoch, he uses the word star, but it's clear from the context that it is an angel. In chapter 20 it says, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. Well, there are two differences here. Now, one is obvious. The first angel in chapter 9 has only a key. The angel in chapter 20 has a key and a chain, because with the chain he's gonna bound. That says something of the authority of the angel. The angel in chapter 9 has the authority to open the pit and to release. The angel in chapter 20 has the authority to open the pit and to bind. There's a different purpose there. But the maybe most interesting difference here is that in chapter 9 it says, "I saw a star fall from heaven." And in chapter 20 says, "I saw an angel come down from heaven." Chapter 9, he falls. In chapter 20, he comes down. Chapter 9 is a falling angel. It is not a good angel. It's a fallen angel. That is a big difference. So God allows him to open the pit, but it's not God's angel. It's one of the fallen angels, whereas in chapter 20 he comes down and he's actually going to bind Satan. That is an angel of God, a good angel, so to speak. God is in control, but he allows evil here, because this is what man is trying to do all since Nimrod, and hasn't stopped until this day. They try to open this pit, they try to get this power that actually inspired by Satan, of course, to ascend above the throne of God. And now God allows it to a certain extent. First of all, the angel has to wait until the trumpet sounds. this fifth trumpet. So God says, okay, now is your time. And if we think again of this opening in the desert, in Babel, if you will, this energy that Nimrod possibly tried to harvest with a tower to open something that is under the earth, you take all these components and you come to one conclusion. CERN is doing exactly that. So the Large Hadron Collider in France, the border of France and Switzerland, is under the earth. Is the largest machine man has ever built. Its energy consumption is beyond imagination. And there is a lot about this thing. Many have already called it the modern Tower of Babel, although it's not a tower, but as we said, it's where its top reaches. That is what it's about, and that is not up, but actually down. This collider is the location is in Saint-Genis-Poly in France, and it's an underground ring, 27 kilometers, which crosses the border of France and Switzerland several times. And Saint-Genis-Poly is the modern name. It's a small town, 7,000 people or so. Poly, the last part of the name, Poly, comes from the Latin Apollo. And there used to be there in the Roman times Apoliacum. That was the name of this town at that time. And there was a temple dedicated to Apollo. And actually, their belief was that was one of the places where there was an entrance to the underworld. So that's the exact location where we find CERN. And I don't think it's by chance. And of course, Apollo ties back to this Saturn V rocket and to the number 5 and all this. Now, Apollo is just a Roman name for what the Greeks called Apollyon, or in the Hebrew tongue, it's Abaddon. It's all the same name, and it has in all the languages the same meaning, namely destroyer. It all means the destroyer. And it's interesting that at the main office of the CERN facility, they have several buildings in this whole area, but in the main office in front of it is a statue of Shiva. And Shiva is the Hindu god, which is called the Destroyer. It's just the Hindu version of Apollo. And goddess it's actually, but it means the same, Destroyer. What we also see in the logo of CERN is three sixes. So it shows again also the mark of who is behind all this. And what is also interesting to know is that underground, it's about 300 feet under the earth, there is a place where they have put panels, and I will put a photo in the video, but they have put panels with ancient texts in actually Mandarin, and Arab, Hebrew and Sanskrit. Sanskrit is in India considered as the language of the gods. So they have put these panels there with these texts, and there is blue lasers that if you would go there and touch it, you break the signal, and it's like a motion alarm that you would find in museum. So they will know that someone goes there to read them. Why are they there? Well, if indeed they want to open this gate and these ancient angels come up, they might be able to read this text. Who knows? Maybe it's a welcoming text. This former director, Sergio Bertolucci, he made mention of this in an interview for a British paper. He said that the supercollider could open, as he said it, his words, quote, otherworldly doors to another dimension for a short fraction of time. However, that may be just enough time to peer into this open door, either by getting something out of it or sending something into it. These are his words. This is supposed to be technician. But in CERN, again, it's the biggest machine that man has ever built. Over 40 nations work on this. So think of Babel, where you have all these nations. Yeah, they were one, but they became scattered. Now you see that all of them are together. In this machine, you find the lowest temperatures that we know in our known universe for cooling down the supermagnets. And when the beams in the collider hit each other, you have the highest temperatures that we know, like 100,000 times higher than the core of the sun. And there are 9,600 magnets on this ring, and they create a magnetic field that is 100,000 times stronger than the Earth's magnetic field. And then when the beams collide, you have particles so small, that's part of what they do, they discover these tiny particles. So in every sense, this machine reaches to the boundaries of our physical world. And you can go into a whole theoretical thing, but if you just think of this, if you go to the boundary or the border of a country and you keep going, you end up in another country. So if you go to the boundaries of our physical world, you keep going, you will leave our physical world, end up in the spiritual world, you will open a gate. That is what they will do. They need, however, something to get it, to make it successful, and that something will be given by this angel with a key. Then locusts will come out. And usually we say this, locusts, but are they locusts? That's the question. He doesn't actually say that they are locusts. He uses the word, but you have to wonder why. And again, I had to read this several times and think about this, but why does he use the word locust? Probably for one reason, and that is because of the nature in which locusts appear. They come in large swarms. Big clouds of them all of a sudden cover the land. And that is probably what he does, why he does this. Because he says they are like the smoke of a furnace, and they darken the sky. And that is exactly what locusts do. This is one of the plagues that comes upon the Egyptians in Exodus 10, verse 13 to 15. And Moses stretched forth his rod over the land of Egypt, and the Lord brought an east wind upon the land, and all that day and all that night. And when it was morning, the east wind brought the locusts. And the locusts went up over all the land of Egypt, and rested in all the coasts of Egypt. Very grievous were they. Before them there were no such locusts as they, neither after them shall be such. For they covered the face of the whole earth, so that the land was darkened. So here we see exactly what John describes. There were so many, they darkened the sky. And that is probably why he uses the word locust, because of this character of this huge swarm. And he says also they are as the smoke of a great furnace. He does not say it was the smoke as of a furnace, but he said they were as the smoke of a furnace. So it's not literally smoke, but that's how they appeared. And indeed, if you see images of these swarms of locusts, it's like clouds, like smoke. And they can darken the land. That is actually the only resemblance with locusts, because other than that, they have no characteristic of locusts, because he says they did not touch anything green. And normally that's exactly what locusts do, they eat all the vegetation. But these locusts don't, so they are not locusts at all. After that, actually, he begins to compare them more to scorpions. And actually, it would be more logic to call them scorpions than locusts for the character. Now, again, we have to always think that John describes with words and concepts that he knows. He cannot use something that he doesn't know, obviously. So, he uses scorpions, doesn't say that they were scorpions, but they had, again, a characteristic of scorpions. And he makes that clear. They knew scorpions very well in the Middle East. We know we have them here also. So in Middle East region, as well as in Africa and in other parts of the world, you have these scorpions, and they are mostly known for their sting and their tail with this sting, and that carries venom, which is in some cases lethal to men, but in all cases it's a neurotoxic, it's paralyzing. That's the purpose. Just like snakes have, they paralyze the enemy and then they can kill it. So think of that it paralyzes men, and it says all men except those that are sealed. This is what we have read before, of course. Those that are sealed are not touched. That also shows that these are supernatural in character, because if this were, as some say, they are helicopters and it's a war and all this, it doesn't work like that. A helicopter cannot see the difference between one who is sealed by the spirit and one who is not. So this is supernatural. And they come also out of this pit, so surely they are. Other symptoms of scorpion venom are a fever, convulsion, increased heart rate, high blood pressure, increased fluid secretion into the lungs and the bronchioles, so the airwaves, airways. So that means coughing and fever. It's indeed torment. If you on top of that are paralyzed, so you can't move, and this lasts for 5 months, I can imagine that you just want to die, because that's horrible. So that's this anguish, and combine that with what we just read from Isaiah 13, what these creatures look like, how terrifying they are, and they are everywhere. This must indeed drive people completely mad. And Job gives a very good description of this wish to die. This is a way of speech to say how much of torment it actually is. In Job 3, verse 20, we'll try to speed up a bit. He says, "Wherefore is light given to him that is in misery, and life unto the bitter in soul, which long for death, but it cometh not, and dig for it more than for hid treasures, which rejoice exceedingly and are glad when they can face the grave." So he emphasizes here how bad this torment is. You just want to die, but death does not come. This is exactly what John describes. So that also shows that God is in control, because God does not allow these creatures to kill. They can torment, but they cannot kill. And also, the time is limited in 5 months. Okay, if you're suffering so much for 5 months, it's a long time, but still, it's limited. Then, finally, we have the angel over them, the king that is over them, called Abaddon. Apollyon or Apollo, it's all the same, and it means to destroy or destroyer. And again, it's the same as in Hindu religion, Shiva, the god of destruction. Some say this is Satan himself, this Abaddon or Apollyon, but we have just read from Enoch that it is not so. Also, it doesn't make sense with regards to what we read later on in chapter 11 and 13. So it's another fallen angel, not being Lucifer. Azaziel is one of these angels that first came down after they had made this agreement to go to earth and go with the women. He was one of these first, one of the leaders, you can say. There were, I think, six or seven of these leaders that are mentioned specifically in Enoch. And he writes about Azaziel, that he taught men to make swords, knives, shields, breastplates, fabrication of mirrors, the workmanship of bracelets, ornaments, the use of paint, the beautifying of the eyebrows, the use of stones of every valuable and select kind, and of all sorts of dyes, so that the world became altered. He was indeed maybe in a sense the worst of them all in what he gave to men. He learned men to make weapons and kill each other, as well as he learned, taught them how to, specifically the women, how to seduce a man using makeup and all this. So there is always a bad side to everything, of course. The mentioning of this angel, Apollo, links all this together. He is linked to the abyss, but he is also linked to Babel, to CERN. So we see how it all comes together. He is called here the king over the locusts. Now, king has power, but he is also a bound angel, and you see that his power is actually very limited, because it's God who controls how long these locusts have authority to torment and what they are able to do. They can't kill. So this king doesn't have so much power. There is also no mentioning what happens to him. There is only mention that he is the king over them, not whether he's actually released from the pit. We can't read it. The locusts are released, but the angel is not mentioned. Or what happens to him afterwards is actually not mentioned. So I assume that he stays in the pit. The locusts come out, but his angel does not. And that makes also sense, since he is not deciding anything. It's God who decides what happens. But he's just mentioned to give us this link, and to, that we can tie everything together and know what it's about. There is this link with Nimrod, and it's just interesting to mention that Nimrod's tomb was discovered in 2003, just shortly before the invasion in Iraq. And one of the first things the Americans did was send a special operations unit to retrieve all the artifacts from the tomb of Nimrod. And they were taken out and flown to the United States. So it's very likely that the key that Nimrod found, or part of it, is in the hands of certain powers right now, and will be used at the time that this fifth trumpet blows. There is much more going on than we know and we hear about. But this discovery of the tomb, you can find it on the internet. It was in the news. It's a very gloomy thing. If you read this whole plague and everything around it, and you see how things have shifted from quote-unquote natural to really supernatural, and you would think that now man understands who God is and that they fall on their knees. But if you go to the end of this chapter, you will see that most of them don't, unfortunately. Again, it shows that God is just, but he is also merciful. He does not give this plague the power to kill. Man is spared and warned once again in a more severe way to wake up and repent. And of course there will be men that will repent, but the majority, as we will read later, won't. And thus God will increase again severity. The next trumpet, it will be more severe once again. So that's for next time. Thank you.